So now we are going to start with the second canto of this mighty book, The Traveler of the Worlds. He is going to step into different domains. He had described the first verse there, the entire hierarchy of the worlds, down, below, up, 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 all that thing. And the scripture says, by putting samyama, identification, with the sun, you had knowledge of all the worlds. Samyama, bhuvanat jnanam. Samyama, surya, suresa jnanam, suresa samyama. So, I don't know, I mean, that is, seems to be very easy. I mean, you concentrate, identify yourself as an, and concentrate means three stages. First is contemplate on the sun, meditate on the sun, and then get absorbed into the sun. When you have gone through those stages, then in that state of total identification with the sun, you get knowledge of the entire cosmic manifestation. Entire cosmic manifestation. Now, well, Shivendu is describing now the entire hierarchy of this world. All these lower planes and higher planes and all that thing. I don't think really he followed that sutra. Identify yourself with the sun and then you get the knowledge. And we really don't know by what process he got the knowledge of the entire hierarchy of this creation and even beyond. In a way, we can understand, we can recognize the fact that Shivendu was not following exactly Patanjali Yoga Sutra, part 3, 25, Sloka 25. He was not following exactly because ultimately the knowledge of the cosmic manifestation is a much smaller thing in Shivendu's reckoning. He has to go still beyond into the Satchitananda worlds. He has to find out the why of this creation, the purpose of this creation, what are the difficulties of this creation, how these difficulties can be met, how they can be solved, what power can bring, can remove the problems which are there in this mortal world. In the verse, Patanjali Yoga Sutra does not really give us a clue for meeting the problem of mortality in the cosmic manifestation. So we can't really say that Shivendu followed Patanjali Yoga Sutra in that sense. But if you are interested only one particular aspect about knowing the cosmic manifestation, then maybe that thing will do. So in that sense, Shivendu's sadhana yoga was also of a totally different kind. Now, is it necessary for me to have a knowledge and identification with all these worlds in the cosmos to do my sadhana? To do my sadhana? That's a very difficult question. Perhaps not necessary. Perhaps not. You may get some general idea, broad outline, certain kind of details here and there, the scheme of things, of operations and all that, but all the minutiae of each and every place, you need not know. Because each individual has his own objective in the spiritual pursuit. Shivendu's objective pursuit was, avataric pursuit was to solve the problem of mortality of this world. And therefore his whole sadhana was tailored, was schemed, was worked out for that particular purpose, you see. Now my sadhana is not for that purpose. To solve the problem of mortality, of falsehood, of pain and suffering, all that thing. My problem is how to grow in my true possibilities. What my transcendental spirit wants to express in this creation here, in this divine manifestation here, that is the only objective I have in my mind. And if I have got that objective alone, then all my effort, all my objectives, all my sadhana, all my pursuits, methodologies, etc., will be for that objective alone. How to express my true personality in this manifestation here. So that way, each individual will have his own separate sadhana. Your sadhana will be different, her sadhana will be different, his sadhana will be different, his sadhana will be different, my sadhana will be different. It is not one sadhana for everybody, you see, that way. So when you are talking, the travel of the world, well, that is for the avatar, for a certain purpose. In other words, in fact, to a certain extent, we can also see that the sadhana of Ashwapati is different than the sadhana of Savitri. They are not the same sadhana. The book of the traveler of the worlds is one part of his sadhana. The earlier was to make his soul free of ignorance, to make his spirit free of bondage of nature and all that thing. Then the cosmic, ultimately his whole objective is bring down that power by which there can be a divine manifestation in the mortal world. So the aim is absolutely fixed and everything is to be worked out towards that objective. So that way, sadhana of Savitri was a different kind. Sadhana of Savitri was basically made for conquering death. She had a specific objective. In the process of the divine manifestation, there is an issue. The divine manifestation is not happening. The divine event is not progressing because on the path is lying the figure of death, of falsehood. And unless that figure of death is removed, divine manifestation cannot happen. So her objective is also fixed in that sense, you see, completely. So that way, we have to really realize that each individual has to have his own sadhana. It is not the same cup for everybody. Each one drinks his own wine with his own taste and enjoys it and lives in that, you see. That is the most important thing. So now we have to understand that, and then what we are now really seeing here is Ashwapati's sadhana. Now, being, so to say, specific to Ashwapati, it may not be really possible for we little mental beings with our own individuality to appreciate the kind of thing which he is experiencing and realizing and possessing, you see. So when he is describing this thing, well, we have to make a sort of a general impression of what has happened here. We can't say that this is exactly like that. So when you say something in the language which he says here, well, maybe that is for Ashwati, not for me. See, we have to kind of give it up like that, you see. So that care we have to take while reading the whole book from Canto 2 to Canto 15, like that, you see. And then we can be on a little safer ground. Now this canto has four sections, 28, 29, 30 and 31, four sections, you see. The first section which we are going to do now has 32 sentences, 149 lines, number of syllables per line roughly 10.67, number of lines per sentence 4.656, words per line 7.134. Now these numbers, number of syllables per line, has to be minimum 10, being a pentametric verse. So here it is 10.7, like that. Throughout you see in Savitri like that, you see. Same way, number of lines, number of words per sentence will be roughly 7 or 8. Number of words per line will be 7 or 8 words. In words, there are many disyllabic words, or trisyllabic words, multiple words like that, you see. So that is why the number of words per line will be less than 10, obviously, see. If it were a monosyllabic line throughout, then there will be exactly 10, see. So these are the statistics of this particular canto. And now let us see to what extent we can really make sense of what is being given to us here in this 149 the lines, you see. It's a fairly big canto also, you see, a big section also. In the impalpable field of secret cell, in the impalpable field of secret cell, secret to us, to our we mental beings. You don't understand. We live only in the surface consciousness, in the secret cell, feel impalpable. We cannot really feel, touch. There is no palpation, perception of that thing at all. Because our mental faculties, our faculties are too gross, too crude to really see the subtle aspects of that particular creation. So he says, in the impalpable field of secret cell, this little outer being's vast support. This little, that is we mental little outer beings, vast support. Now, that's the majesty, that is the beauty, that is the paradox also, that we are small little creatures, tiny, pygmy, petty people, but it needs a vast support. See, the smallness cannot come without that vastness supporting it, you see. Vast support of the secret cell is what makes us small, you see. Parted from vision by earth's solid fence. This field is parted from vision by earth's solid fence. The earth itself is acting as a fence. It is not allowing to go into beyond that thing. He came into a magic crystal air. He came into a magic crystal air, transparent, lucent, beautiful air. He, of course, stands here for Ashwapati, the traveler of the worlds, to be more precise, the traveler of the worlds. See, in these descriptions, that he can be immediately identified with Ashwapati, Ashwapati or the legend. As I said, traveler of the world, could have all the three meaning. Traveler of the world could mean in the legend Ashwapati. Traveler of the world in the symbol could mean the divine soul. The traveler of the world could mean more than the symbol and the legend figure. He could mean the evolutionary being himself. Evolutionary being himself. He came into a magic crystal air. Magic. It looks suddenly, puzzling, difficult. Cannot understand what that thing is. And found a life that lived not by the flesh. Life without flesh. There are beings, but they don't need the physical flesh, the vital support for that kind of a thing, you see. So this magic, this realm in which he is entering is something more of a subtle kind. A light that made visible immaterial things. And found a life that lived, he found a life that lived not by the flesh. He found a light that made visible things which are not material. Immaterial things become visible. So that is the kind of a light he is seeing now here. Our gross senses, our physical sight is unable to really look into that kind of a thing at all. It has no, in fact, we say our light, that is the lightest kind of a thing here. But if you really talk in terms of light, the photon, the particle of light, I mean, it is a kind of a weight, it is a kind of a heaviness, it is a kind of an inertia, it is a kind of a mass. It is a mass, and that is not really subtle enough. Our physical light, which you get, is not really subtle enough at all, you see. But here is a light which has, in a way of speaking, no mass, no inertia. It is just illumination by itself, you see. A light that made visible immaterial things. Now, immaterial things are very difficult. How can we imagine that immaterial things become visible by light? But there is a light there because he is entering into a magical world. So, I mean, he has taken care of our objections by saying magic. How the light can see something which is immaterial?